My talk will concentrate on the question of how nuclear power can, in fact, be made safer should Japan decide in the future, the recent future, presumably, on whether or not it will proceed to have a significant nuclear future. So the question at hand that I'd like to discuss is what needs to change in order to make nuclear power safer? And my contention is that there are two separate issues, one having to do with technology, that is, what are the safety-related issues on the technology side that need to be addressed in ways that we already know today how to address? And finally, what are the organizational changes that need to be made in order to actually be able to provide safe nuclear power? And I'd like to talk about each one of these in turn. So first, let's talk about technology. It's interesting to observe that if one looks at all of the past truly catastrophic nuclear accidents, they all had something in common, which is the failure to maintain a cooled nuclear core, reactor core. This is true for Chernobyl, it's true for Three Mile Island, it's true for Fukushima. So the obvious question is there a technology that addresses this issue? Is there a technological answer to addressing this problem? And my answer is fundamentally yes. We do know how to address this problem. That is that there exist designs of nuclear plants in which passive safety is a distinct feature, where you rely on fundamental physics, the behavior of materials, not complex safety systems or automatic backup systems, in order to accomplish the goal, which is to make sure that the core is cooled. And the two examples that I'll talk about have to do with the natural shutdown of the chain reaction with the reactor, something that you might call a natural scram. A scram is the shutdown of the chain reaction. And finally, natural core cooling, even in the absence of power to the reactor. So the first example is a physics-based scram, a physics-based turn-off of the chain reaction. The fundamental principle that this appeals to is the fact that when I take a material such as a metal and I heat it, it will expand. That is the fundamental principles. And the number of reactor designs, for example, the high-temperature gas-cooled pebble bed reactors, or the Toshiba 4S reactor, which is a metal, liquid metal-based reactor, both exploit this simple principle in order to shut a reactor down, shut the chain reaction down, if core cooling fails. Basically, the expansion the physics behind it is extremely simple. It simply ensures that as the core expands, the probability of neutrons causing further chain reaction, hitting nuclei causing the generation of more neutrons, that probability simply decreases, simply because the amount of material, the density of the material, decreases. The second example has to do with natural cooling. And this is an effect that all of us are familiar with if you ever put a pot of water on a stove. That is, you turn the heat on, and if the water in the pot is being heated from below, what you see eventually is the movement of water, convection. And one can, in fact, design a reactor vessel in which even the absence of any power, so there is no power to the pumps, the liquid that carries the heat from the fuel, from the burning chain reaction, is able to actually carry the heat away to the external world. So this is a fundamental principle which has already been exploited in a number of reactor designs. There are designs, for example, by several U.S. vendors, Empower, NuScale, Holtec, Westinghouse. Westinghouse, as you probably know, is actually a Japanese corporation, which are small modular reactors that use water, so these are light water reactors, And there are liquid metal, small modular reactor designs by GE Hitachi and the Toshiba 4S, that also exploit the ability of water to simply, in the presence of an overload of heat, of carrying the heat away. The second issue that I mentioned has to do with organization. Now, nuclear power is unique among all energy generation technologies in that it is truly high-tech. It requires a high level of technical expertise on the part of the folks operating the nuclear plant. So that means that the on-site workforce needs to be highly trained. It has to have sufficient experience so that if the unexpected happens, and accidents are, in fact, unexpected, that they know how to deal with that. The second point is that the senior management of the operator needs to be able to trust the on-site experts, because in an emergency, it's always the on-site experts that need to react to what is actually going on in real time. So there cannot be any second guessing on the part of management of what is going on site. And so this combination of true expertise and a reliance and trust on the workforce is extremely important. So if you think about the critical organizational ingredients, some of them actually harken back to some of the things that you've just heard both from Professor Sagan and from Professor Williams. You need a highly trained and trusted workforce. You need to have preparation and training in place in case emergencies happen. And we have to understand that emergencies are by their very nature unexpected. So you have to have a workforce that is trained for the unexpected. You need to have a transparent chain of command and responsibilities. What does that mean? That means that everybody needs to know what their job is, and they need to know that before the emergency, not during the emergency. You need a way of checking that all these things that I've just talked about are in fact implemented. It's a fundamental point that Professor Williams just made. You need independent verification and validation of what the workforce is like, to what extent the safety and security issues have been dealt with, and in fact, whether or not appropriate preparations have been made for the unexpected. And finally, you need a culture on the part of the operator that understands that safety, implementing safety, is actually a way of making money, that safety is not something that costs you things, but actually is a way of making money. That is, safety and operational efficiency are very, very closely coupled. This has been, in fact, the experience in the United States. And to the extent that the operator is motivated by a profit motive, this also gives the profit motive an impetus toward increased safety. So you might ask, these are fine words, but can all of these things, in fact, be achieved? And my answer is a resounding absolute yes. The first example is actually in the United States, the American nuclear navy. All of the ingredients that I talked about, including to some extent also the profit motive, that is making sure that everything works properly, are in place. And it's interesting to note that in the nuclear navy of the U.S., there have been no accidents and no deaths in over 50 years of service. And I would like to just note as an aside that the personnel, the people that actually operate these reactors on board ships, tend to be 17 or 18 years old. They're very young. The second example is the industry in the United States post Three Mile Island. There are two things that happened after Three Mile Island. The first is that an independent regulatory system was put in place, independent oversight by the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, and industry itself decided to self-regulate. If you go to the website that I've indicated there, INPO is an industry organization that basically ensures that the industry itself pays attention to the safety and security issues that we've been talking about. And the end result of this has been that there have been no significant accidents no deaths in the United States, no significant contamination since the three-mile accident, and on top of that, the operations have been significantly increased in their efficiency, and these companies turn out to have made a lot more money. So the obvious question, how might this apply to present-day Japan? The first one has to do with just my first point about the technology. And it's interesting to note that Japan, the folks that actually are involved in designing and building nuclear plants, have been among the forefront in the world in designing new generations of reactors that are, in fact, inherently passively safe. This is true for Hitachi, Westinghouse, is true for Toshiba. So this is passive safety by design, not by retrofit. And I think there needs to be a change. So to some extent, the future for Japan is already in place if one relies on Japanese industry. Change safety culture, the first steps have already been taken. As I think all of you know, Japan has made the decision to have independent oversight. That has, in fact, already occurred. And the question at hand is, will one also see in Japan a changed operator culture, a recognition that good safety practices and efficient operations go hand in hand, that they're strongly coupled, and therefore that safety is not a burden, but actually a way of increasing one's profit. So with that, I'd like to thank you.